We would like to acknowledge the traditional owners of the country throughout Australia from which we conduct our podcast. We would like to pay our respects to their elders, past, present, and emerging.
Hey guys, welcome back to Beers and Tears. Today we are joined with Oly Sherman. Hello, how are you?
Yeah, how's it going?
Good, thank you. So, when did you first start, like, making music? Or knowing that you were decent at it to make it a career?
Yeah, I did music all through school. I started off playing guitar, and then I think just one of those, like, assessments, I just sung, and my teachers thought it was good, and like I didn't really know what to expect from singing or how really to do it. I kind of just got passionate about it, like it just kind of snowballed, and then I kind of thought I was good at it, but you never really know, I guess. And then consistently just trying to learn by myself, really. It's kind of weird when you think about it, but yeah, it's been quite a personal thing, like kind of self-taught for years now. So yeah.
Sweet. And do you just, what instruments do you play?
I started playing guitar, and then I also write on the piano and stuff like that. But I did like a year and a half of drums, and I've tried to like expand, you know, my knowledge. But then, yeah, I think mainly just guitar and vocals, really.
Nice. Is that all self-taught?
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah, so it's I can't agree that it's probably like the traditional. Like I always think, like I play piano and it's in videos and stuff like that. And I always think if you know, some piano don saw that, and they'd get so offended. But I think just the way I play kind of just suits my personality, I think. It's something I want to do, like go back to real basics, but for now I'm kind of just working off sounds. And
I think that people who like never got lessons, I find that they're always more creative with how they play, because nothing's ever wrong in their eyes. So like if it sounds good, because like I always got like lessons, and I found that like if I saw someone do something, like one of my mates or something, that wasn't right but it sounded good, I would always feel so weird about it. But I always find them way more creative with their music. So yeah, I think that's
yeah, I think that's the way. But yeah.
So you released your first track in like what, 2017? What made you like finally decide to actually like put music out into the world rather than it be sort of like a personal hobby?
I think it all happened like super quickly. I remember like all I was doing was like recording on my phone and just listening back to them, trying to like, essentially I didn't really know how songwriting works. I would kind of just record on my phone and just had like thousands of recordings, and then downloaded Logic, did all that jazz, and then kind of just put stuff together. And God, like I listen to some of that stuff now and I kind of cringe, but it's when I had it all together and I kind of got a collection of things, I kind of just researched how to release stuff, and then I just put it out, and then it kind of just worked from there. Well, I haven't really thought about that in a long time, but yeah, I don't think there's any wrong way to, you know, put something out first. There's always that hurdle. Yeah, I think I literally just put it out, and I didn't really know what to expect. Yeah.
Did you ever like feel uncomfortable like putting music out that is like personal to you? Was that ever like a thing that stopped you from putting music out for however long?
I think it's interesting. I think the songs themselves and the subject matter weren't as personal to me as probably a lot of people think. It was more the feeling of of listening to music and the feeling of like remembering songs that you like and singing things that you like was personal to me. But in terms of like the first few songs I ever wrote and released and stuff like that, they were merely just like, this sounds cool. Like that, yeah. That solitude feeling of writing by yourself is what means something to me. And then the actual song that comes out is just a result of that. So it's kind of funny looking at it like that. But yeah, I think, I can't even know what your question was now, but.
You've answered it.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Perfect.
Cool. Yeah.
And do you like self-produce? Like you mentioned, you like did some work on Logic and stuff. Do you still like put that stuff out by yourself, or have you worked with a producer since?
Yeah. So I started doing it all by myself, and then obviously because I'm self-taught in that aspect as well, it's obviously I assumed it was obviously not going to be as good enough. And when you put something out, I was always worried, like, oh, like, is the volume even going to be too low for someone else to speak? Like, that's the shit you kind of don't learn by yourself. So, yeah, so I, with my second EP, I started working producer back in Sydney, Daniel Natoli, and he kind of worked a lot with live bands and stuff like that, but he kind of taught me the basis of leveling everything out, and then I've been working with him ever since, and he kind of just does finishing touches off my works. So I kind of do everything what I can here and there, and then I bring it to him and he goes, yeah, that's soft, that needs to go, like that kind of thing. So it's a mix.
So it sounds like you still have like a lot of control over the production process now, even though you are working with producers and that.
Yeah. I think he's more this is what it could sound like, and we go back to a lot of references and stuff like that, which is how I know a lot of people work. But he's saying, like, do you want, like, you've got three options for this sound, for example, A, B, and C, close your eyes, which one sounds good to you, which one sounds like what you predicted it was going to be, and it's kind of that kind of thing. So yeah, I think the control is, I still feel like I still have the control.
Yeah, that's really nice.
In terms of that. That's good. So, yeah.
And so, like, I think the first song I ever heard of yours was Pain Free Melody. And I think that's probably the same for a lot of people who first hear your music. Yeah. Did you, when you, like, released it, did you expect it to kind of, like, take off like it did?
That's the thing. I think that's what, as you said, like, a lot of people, even today, like discovering that early stuff for the first time. And I've been like thinking about it a lot, but like my head and my the music I listen to is so different to that like 2 or 3 years ago, but then still remembering people are still listening to that for the first time. So yeah, I don't think I expect anything. I remember the first release I put out, I was like, oh, when I got a little bit of hype or whatever, I was like, oh, I had like these certain expectations. And then obviously sometimes that'll get met and then, you get sad about that. So every release for the last couple of years, I just don't have any expectation. I try not to. I think it's best to just try and make music that gives me like kind of goosebumps, and then whatever just comes from there. So with that particular song, no, I didn't really know anything about what it was going to do or anything like that, but it seems to be a lot of people's favorite, which is cool.
Yeah. And are you happy that that is like the song that a lot of people first hear, or would you rather it be like a different song, like one of your favorites?
No, I'm pretty happy because I like the song. I don't think there's many songs that I released that I don't like. No, I do like the song, and I we love playing it live and stuff like that. So I think it's always going to be one of those songs I do like.
That's good because like it's always sad when like there's a really popular song and like everyone loves it, but you would get sick of it because it's just like played all the time and like you have to play it at every gig. So like it's nice.
Yeah, I'm not like playing it on stage like looking completely emotionless or anything like that. I think which. It's just quite funny. But yeah, no, I do like the song.
That's good. So, well, since you released all, like, your old music, you've released a bunch of music and since then, and now finally an album. Do you want to tell us a little bit about, like, the process behind the album and how long it took you? Because it's, like, your first album.
Yeah. I didn't actually plan on releasing an album, but, like, when I started doing all the music and stuff like that, I was like, oh, albums are, you know, for when you're fully established and stuff like that, and you've got such a basis to work off and you can release something that big. But I did, when I started doing a bunch of those songs, it wasn't going to be an album at all. I was just going to do like EPs and EPs. But I think when the first kind of lockdown happened in Sydney, which was all for everyone really last year, that's when I kind of sifted through old things, old songs, recordings, and tried to put them all together in a way that was like a smaller project. And then songs just, I kept forgetting about, came up. And then I kind of was talking to my managers and stuff like that. And I came up, like, the idea being like maybe just do an album, like, fuck it kind of thing. And then that kind of consumed everything I was doing for months and months. I knew it was going to be a lot of work, but it's something that I didn't think it was going to be like as much work as I thought it was going to be. Like, there's so much that goes into it, not just musically, but just like you end up thinking about it every day and it like literally consumes you. So did not think it was going to be an album, but I'm like pretty stoked if it was. There's a lot of songs on that album that probably wouldn't have been released otherwise if it hadn't been all part of that era I was writing in. So I think the album was the best outcome because it didn't get rid of a lot of songs, but it got out a lot of songs I had the years, really. So
that's awesome. I love when because so many songs just get like left behind. I always talk to people and they just like,
yeah,
they just get left behind, like they just get put into a hard drive or something and never really looked at again. So it's nice to hear that, like, you know, you went back on them. That's lovely.
Yeah. Yes.
Did you ever get to the point where, I don't know, you're listening to it so much that it just doesn't even sound good anymore?
All the time. Not necessarily not good, but I'm like just so, because obviously the things you write about change, like, you know what I mean? Like, there's a song on the album that was literally about, I think I met a girl years ago. And I came to Melbourne to see her and stuff like that. And then it was like, it didn't work out. But that song's literally about that time. And then I'm like so far from that. And it's quite funny going back on that. Even when I play it live and stuff like that, just I don't think about when it was written or anything like that. So, I think just songs like that just change and the perceptions change. And obviously when people hear it, they think it's about something else. And it's quite funny. So I think they're probably meant to change. And I think when you release a song, it just kind of has the freedom to do that. It might mean something different to me in another year. So
yeah,
I think that's kind of cool anyway. So
are you an artist that like explains some of your songs like at your show, or do you let it leave it up for interpretation?
But I mean, if I want it to come across a certain way, I'll say something, but
yeah,
I'm not much of a talker on stage. I never plan what to say, anything like that. I think sometimes like, you know, that shitty banter will come out, but I don't really explain the meaning behind the song unless it's important to me. I'll be like, this one's really important to me. Mm. And then we play it because I still like that interpretation from everyone else. And you know, I don't want anyone to feel a certain way when they listen to it, just only what's natural to them, because that's how I listen to music. So
and did you have a holistic like sort of feeling or meaning or message behind the album by any chance, or was it just sort of like old memories like coming to be sort of thing?
Yeah, I think a little bit of both. As I said, a lot of the songs from the album were written during a certain time, and that time wasn't particularly great for me. So I think all those songs kind of, yeah, they come under that theme. But then again, when listening to them, it doesn't really bring me back there. It's kind of just like a, you know, it's like if you're writing a page in a journal, it's kind of just there. And then when you look back on it, it might not affect you the same way. So yeah, a lot of those songs are written in a certain time and mindset. And I think the album itself is kind of just about that, for me at least. There's no real concept to it other than the kind of just honesty about it, really, I think. Yeah, if that makes any sense.
Really. Yeah, no, it does. Yeah. Do you have like a preference of, like, would you prefer to like perform songs that you wrote a while ago that are just like sort of like a distant memory kind of thing, or like something that you're really feeling at the time? Like, do you like differentiate between the two, or is it kind of just like you're really in the zone when you're playing them?
I think, yeah, I'd be in the zone when I'm playing them, but I think, like, say when I listen to music, I don't know about you guys, but if I hear a song that I'm like absolutely like loving and I just keep playing it over and over again, I don't even like think of the subject matter of what they're saying. Yeah, it's kind of just the melody and the rhythm or the beat, whatever, just like hits you, right? So I try and write music like that as well. Otherwise I'll probably hate it. If I write a song and the subject matter is like, you know, cool, break up, whatever, but the beat sucks, I'm gonna hate the song, even though the lyrics are really cool. I think that stuff has to, I mean, for me, that stuff has to be there first, because that's why I listen. So, yeah, I mean, yeah.
No, I like that. Because you know, you never want to get sick of a song. That's like my worst nightmare, when I'm like loving a song and then all of a sudden one day I'm like, I don't want to listen to this anymore. And then it comes back a few years later when you like it again. But that's kind of like the best music.
And I'll hear a song and I fucking kill it like 100 times a day until I'm like, oh great, like, but I can't help it really. So
I'm the same. I'll have one song that I listen to for about 2 weeks.
It's pretty funny that way it works. But
what song is that for you right now? Do you have a song that you're loving?
Well, I've got Spotify right next to me on this, so I think my I tried to do like a playlist, like a weekly playlist.
Oh, nice.
Which everyone can kind of check out. It's called OS Weekly, which is not most creative name, but I just kind of do like 25 songs a week that I'm kind of vibing and stuff like that. But a lot of the music I listen to at the moment just don't really have any lyrics in them. I love cinematic instrumental music at the moment. I don't know why, it just kind of lets me think a lot more, and like even when I'm in the car, I can't do radio stations. I all I listen to is like classical FM, like quite literally, just because I just think and it's not, I don't know, someone's going, this is the new thing, and it's getting shoved down your throat and you're like, oh, like I can't even think right now. So that's kind of what I've been obsessed with at the moment, just songs that allow me to think, really.
There's like a whole study on that. That's like the best thinking music is classical music.
And I guess that's probably what it's doing, but I find it really cool.
Nice, that's very interesting. So you had a couple of collabs on your album. How did they kind of come to be? Are they like friends of yours, or like what was the go with them?
Yeah, so they're all kind of friends of mine. So Kieran, or KB Hides, is the rapper on one of my tracks. I met him a few years ago when I was doing a gig in Canberra, and he also knows my drummer. I met him, and his flow and his rapping is just like next to none, really. I mean, like, you obviously hear rapping, you know, in songs on the internet, but when you actually see it, or when you see the way they think, which I'd never experienced before, I saw the way he thought and the way he could just pull stuff out and his memory and stuff like that. I just thought it was so cool. And he's really a really authentic guy. And like, we just kind of hit it off instantly. and we just wrote a song, and it kind of worked. And then Aya, who was on the second track of the album, I was playing a run of shows in Japan, maybe like this was just before lockdown, and she was just there. She was in like the staff accommodation that we were staying in, and I just met her there, and she was a musician and everything like that. So yeah, we just kind of hit it off, and then invited her in the studio one day, and we just kind of wrote that. And then a lot of the bass playing on the album is one of my good friends, Ali, who plays bass for a lot of DJs and stuff like that. But they're all friends, all really nice to work with. I think that's kind of what I like doing, working with people like that you can enjoy it rather than sorting someone for what they've done in the past, like purely for that. I think I've got to know them and kind of vibe with them anyway. So
sure. And if you could collaborate with anyone in the world, alive or dead, who would you want to collaborate with?
That's fucking hard. There's a lot of, like, in terms of if I was going to sing on a track, like guy out of the UK, SG Lewis, at the moment, he's like, he does a lot of work. He just released an album with a crazy amount of collaborations. Like, he did work with like Nile Rodgers and all that stuff, but he's like a really cool DJ. I'd love to sing on one of his tracks. But then I would also love to like just sit and chat and play guitar with like John Mayer and all that. I don't know. There's so many artists out there like in different aspects that I'd love to work with, but I think I'd be fucking too nervous to work with any of those people anyway. So I don't know. Who knows? It's too hard.
It's so interesting, the different genres as well. Cause you wouldn't get like John Mayer on an SG Lewis track. Maybe you would, who knows? But it's like so different.
Yeah, I'd listen to that, but I don't think it'll happen. But
yeah. So what is your like your favorite song that you've released from your album?
So there's a song on there called Favors. And that was a song, I think that was the only song on the album which I'd like listen to leisurely. I don't really like when my music comes up, I don't really like listening to it. It's just a weird thing I don't like doing. But this song was kind of that first one where I did, because of, as I was talking before, because of the like the phrasing and all the melodies that are going on, this stuff that I really like listening to anyway. That song was a big influence off the Paper Kites and the stuff they kind of do with their band. I think that's kind of my favorite song, purely just because I like listening to it as I kind of forget it to me in a way, which might be really egotistical, but I kind of forget it to me singing and I can enjoy it in a certain way, in contrast to the other song. So yeah, that would have to be my favorite, purely just because I like the sound of it. I mean,
that's cool. Yeah. And so you've played some shows recently. Do you have a favorite like memory that you've had at a show, or in contrast, like a very bad memory that you wish never happened?
I think, yeah, I've got both for that. I think I'll start with the bad one. I remember playing at Oxford Art Factory, and this would have been like second or third band gig like I'd ever played. So I just met these guys, and my band are like incredible at what they do. Like they're all crazy good at their instruments. So this is me coming in with my songs, being like, hey guys, like hope you like it, like hope you stay with me, type of thing. We start playing one of my new songs, and I'm just completely out of key. It was just like a wig out, and I had to start again. That was so bad. And then I think the best memory, that's never happened again, by the way.
I can bet.
The best memory was probably the last show we played, the Lansdowne in Sydney. And that was, we ended up selling that out. It was like 200 to 300 people. And it was like the first full room I'd played since the lockdowns came out. all the venues were allowed people back. And I remember kind of, I knew there were people coming, obviously, but I remember when I walked out, it was like it's the first time I had completely full room, and everyone was like stoked. That was incredible. That took me like maybe 3 or 4 days to like come down from that gig. So I think, I think that show was probably the best in terms of heights. Yeah.
Do you remember the first gig that you ever played?
So I used to play a lot of, I used to play at a lot of like bars and stuff like that with an old friend of mine, like playing guitar and playing like shitty covers and stuff like that. So I think the first ever gig we played was at like a markets. You know how they have like music in markets and so or whatever. Like we did that, and man, like wouldn't want anyone to listen to what that sounded like then. But that was the very first memory I have of actually like, you know, playing within a certain time and we've got 5 minutes to go, like 3 songs that like all that shit, right? Like that's fine now, but like back then it was such a big deal, like trying to organize that stuff. So yeah, playing a lot of like Mumford and Sons covers at markets was probably my first memory of playing, really.
That's so wholesome to think about. To go back on that. So what is the plan now that your album is out finally? What's the go? Have you got gigs coming up?
Yeah, so I had a run of rural shows. I was actually supposed to be coming to Melbourne, but everything is kind of slowly getting cancelled and stuff like that, which it's quite predictable at the moment, so it's not too much it's not too much of a bummer. But yeah, there's definitely sure. I've got another big Mansell show in August, depending on obviously how everything goes. But I've had a bit of a I had to take a bit of a breather once the album did come out. I was kind of expecting myself to keep up the same level of productivity and stuff like that, but I really struggled to try and wind down. So the last couple of weeks have been pretty chill, but I've written another 10 or 20 songs that are like, I think I want to start a new project, but I think there's no real plan. I think I'm just going to play these shows, continue to enjoy the album, let everyone enjoy the album, and then decide a bit later, I think. So
yeah, lovely. Yeah. You gotta live your life a bit to have experience.
Yes.
Like you think.
Yes. I find that very hard. I feel pressured to constantly do music, but yeah, a lot of people are just saying just chill, like enjoy it. So that's what I'm trying to do. Yeah.
Especially in lockdown.
Yeah,
there's not much I can do at the moment. So everyone's doing walks, but that's about it.
Walks! I remember that. So, do you guys have like a limit on like how long you can be outside for?
It's honestly insane. It's like, I didn't think there's a limit. At the first lockdown there was, it was like people sitting down, people would like, you know, be like, oh, come on, you're going to ruin it for everyone. But now like I've got like a park down the road and it's like no one's ever walked in their life now. Like you go down there and there's fucking people everywhere. So
yeah,
it feels icky. So yeah.
Icky.
Yeah, it does. Yeah.
Well, it's been a pleasure having you on the podcast today.
Thank you.
You have a lovely rest of your day. When does your lockdown finish?
Well, we just went into an extension week yesterday, so we've got another week, but who bloody knows, really?
Yeah.
Hopefully it's only the 3. I think we only copped a 3-week
when
we went into it for the second time.
Sure, okay.
So fingers crossed that's the
fingers
case.
Fingers crossed, yeah.
But yeah, we usually do a little bit of a beers and cheers at the end of our video. So if you have a coffee cup or a whatever the heck you have we usually do a bit of a cheers. So cheers. Thank you so much for joining us.
Cheers. Thank you so much for having me.